Well, welcome to another edition of Harry's Garage. Now, if you've watched some of my videos from the past, you will know that most of the cars in the garage tend to feature a V12 engine. I'm a bit hooked on sort of supercar Lamborghinis and Ferraris and all sorts of things with V12 engine. But I thought it was high time I actually introduced you to the oldest car on the fleet, my Series 1 Land Rover. This is a 1954 Series 1 2-litre 86 wheelbase. And it's turning quickly into the family pet. This is what we use around the farm all the time. It's incredibly capable. It has a sophistication probably just above one of my garden mowers, but that's actually what makes it so lovable. It's an icon. It's been around for 60 years, and I suggest that if you think of Land Rover, this is the car you sort of picture in your mind. Wonderfully capable, incredibly basic, as I say. And I'm going to take you around some of the details because it won't take long, but you just can't help but fall in love with this car, and I'll show you why. Now, a little bit of history on this model. They did the prototypes. They wanted to find out a sort of farmer's friend of a car that could go anywhere, have four-wheel drive, and they were sort of impressed with the Jeep. Rover wanted to produce their own car, and this was the result. The very early ones are recognisable because the headlights are actually behind a grille. So that you see these big headlights on this one. This is quite a modern one because it's 1954, and we're talking about 1948 when it first came out. It had a shorter wheelbase. The early ones, they were 80 instead of 86. They grew to 86 as this one is about 53, 54. And I chose that one because it just makes it more usable. This is actually a working vehicle. This is not a museum piece on the farm. We use it daily. I can't keep the kids out of it. So we wanted the practicality of a slightly longer rear deck to carry stuff. And when we get the inside, it changed again on the inside. I find that exhaust slightly incongruous, that way that exhaust hangs down there. It seems very vulnerable, but I've never hit it. Come round, it's already sprung. And then you get to the back, and you see we have the bench seats in here because it's a very good tool for taking people down the pub and things like that. I'll show you the two extras that the owner, the chap I bought it from, was completely in love with this vehicle. He'd owned it since 98 and fortunately had fell ill and couldn't really drive it anymore. The two items he gave me was a can of green paint, because you just hand paint these things if you see something like the paintwork needs doing, and this, which to go on the grill in case you're in really deep water. If I'm having to use that on the grill, I think I'll just use a boat rather than this. But that was the two things he gave me. He had a huge amount of fun. He used to do like quite a lot of off-road trialing with it, because these things are incredibly capable off-road. I mean, all the Land Rovers are, but this one, what makes it so good is how light it was. When I actually looked at the spec, I couldn't believe how light it was. It's this thing running, as you see it now, with fuel, is 1,243 kilos, all up, ready to go. That's half the weight of today's Range Rover, and about 500-600 kilos lighter than the Defender, today's Defender. Amazingly light, but there's nothing to it. You can see, fabric top, all aluminium bodywork. There's this lattice sachet underneath, which we'll see. Proper basic, but the result is that ultra-light weight. Here's another neat trick with this Land Rover. It's a conventional door from the outside, which it is. Well, I love the way, firstly, it opens all the way around to there, so you can get in and out, whatever you're wearing, big boots, etc. But here's another neat trick, because I might give this a little tweak. Hey presto, the top of the door comes off. And I have to say, this is how we use it most of the summer. Open like that, we roll the sides up, and it's sort of like safari land. A bit drafty, but great fun. You might have spotted, eagle-eyed amongst you, there's no petrol cap. That's because it hides in a very secret spot, which is under the driver's seat. So the first thing you do is take the driver's squab off like that. When you're met with that, this is a little catch here. Take that off. And revealed there is the petrol tank. And the idea is, you then take that off. Whoa, give this a little wriggle. That helps you guide the fuel in. I always think it looks rather suspicious when you're filling this car up, though. Because you're sort of standing there, what do people think as you're sort of filling up from the driver's seat? I'm going to do a world first. I'm going to show you, you can actually see the petrol in there. So you've got a visual check. Probably never been done before. I don't know if you can see anything. Oh, here we go. There's the fuel, bit of sediment at the bottom, and there's the little fuel sender. So that tells me how full I am, as that float goes up and down.
I think that might be a world first. Now the engine. 1954 means this car has the 2-litre engine, which is something I was looking for. At launch there was 1600cc petrol. There is a diesel in the early range in the 50s, but it's a really rattly old thing and an acquired taste. So they're generally all petrol. 1600 at the start, as I say, it was a bit lacking in power. So they soon improved it and came out with a 2-litre engine, which is what this car's got. Now to get in, take these spring clips off either side. This is a bit heavy because obviously it's got a spare wheel on the top. Otherwise it's a bit light as a feather because this car is made completely of aluminium. If I grab the camera and just show you some of the highlights, there aren't many highlights, so this won't take long. Radiator at the front, you never really look at it. An oil bathed air filter. Of course, a carburetor, no such thing as injection in these days. A little fuel pump, which you'll hear rattle away in the future when we start it up. Distributor there, side valves. So there's a side valve here for the exhaust. Inlet valves are at the top. And this mighty engine produces 52 horsepower, which from 2 litres is not a lot. Scale it up and you think you've had a 6-litre engine producing 150 horsepower. That's not very impressive. What is impressive is it just runs on any fuel. We are sort of used to 95 octane and 97, 98 super unleaded. This thing runs on 80. As long as you get 80 octane fuel, you're fine. You can actually run it, according to the handbook, for lower than 80 octane, but you have to knock back the ignition timing. But 80 octane is just anything that's vaguely flammable, and this thing will run. Around the back, what you get is a fold-down tailgate, which is pretty strong. So I can happily jump up and down on it. What I like about this car is carrying capacity. With a driver, you can put 500 kilos, half a ton in the back of here. And these early ones had relatively soft springing, so it's not too bad. If you go for a later Land Rover, anybody will know Series 2, Series 3, whose own ones, they're really very stiff because they upped the capacity, carrying capacity, but made the springs even stiffer, and it's quite a bouncy ride. This one isn't too bad. Now, I don't normally do this, but it's actually probably worth putting the camera underneath this car because it's so unique. It has this ladder chassis that has served Land Rover so well. Say 60 years old, and this is still there on the Defender now, and you can see what gives this car its strength and how it works so well. Here we go. Now, the easiest place to see the chassis is right at the front here, because these two members, one here coming onto the bumper and here, is sort of the end of the chassis. And then you can see where the springs are attached there, front spring hangers there and there, and this great big axle. And it's that chassis that goes all the way through to the back. That's what makes it unique and so incredibly strong. And means it lasts 60 years. Also, like, there is the, under the door, you can see the petrol tank sort of hanging out. And then, here are your levers. See, in the door, these, that's let's get it right, that'd be clutch, and that's the brake in the middle. So just completely exposed, you all adjust it, it's so easy. So, as I say, it's more in common with a mower than it has with a car of today. And then around at the back, those chassis rails, you can just see at the back there coming off and coming around, and another great B axle on the back. Anyway, enough of the mechanicals, I think we ought to go and see how it drives. Okay, right, inside, very basic, as you can see, there is a multitude of gear levers. I'll take you through what these do when we go out on the field, but there's these special ones here. There's another one here, main gear change here. Those are little power outlets you can have. Hardly any switch gear. This one actually turns on the lights behind the dial, so that has a separate switch for some reason. This is the one key, the one and only key. And if I turn this on, as soon as you turn it on, you'll hear the electric fuel pump. And it'll do a couple of gulps and fill the carburetor. It doesn't take very long. So here we go. That's about it. Under here, we have a little choke, sorted by the orange light there. And to start it, you don't twist the key again. You press this little starter button down here. It's about the only thing it shares with a Ferrari Enzo or something like that, is a starter button. A highly
optimistic or pessimistic fuel gauge, not really to be relied on. Dynamo, so I can see it's charging if I rev it. There we go. There we are, see that? There we go. And then the speedo, a mighty 70 miles an hour. Well, you'll never see 70 miles an hour. You sort of, I remember a childhood on the farm looking at these things and dreaming to see if I could get the needle beyond 50 miles an hour. So 50 is its sort of top speed. I did note in the spec there is no 0 to 60 time for a Series 1 because they can't actually do 60 miles an hour. They do a 0 to 40 time, which is horrific, like half a minute, 30 seconds or something like that. Anyway, that's that. This is how you do the lights. It's just around here. I now know I'm on main beam. I also know I'm on main beam because I look at the alternator. It can't quite keep up with the drain of the mud. Right, so I have to rev it and just about produce enough electricity to put the main beam. And if you just pull out, here on the wheel is the dip control. So I go main beam or dip off there, which is bizarre. Horn in the middle. And then all this says central. As I steer, you see that central bit, it says static. It just caught me out, to begin with. Now, other bits that are just delightful on a Series 1 and on other Range Rovers are these. These are the air vents, which you get instant cooling air just by opening this flap, and then you just have a blast of cold air coming at you, which is just great. They're not on the early Series 1s, but on the 86 inch they appeared. The wipers, the bizarre wipers. You have to turn these on. Oh, and here we go, and we're off. And what I love about these is you have to turn one individually. So when it's, if it's really raining, oh, I can park them as well, just park them there. If it's really raining, I have to put both wipers on. Normally I just do it with the one, but it's the only car I know that has individual wipers for passenger and driver. Down here, if we come down to here, this is an optional extra. This is the heater. So this just gets warm, and I have a button somewhere. Where's the button? Oh, I can't remember. There we are. And that's how I turn the heater on. If I want to demist the window, I close these flaps so I don't get any air into the footwell. It blasts up these, and these coil pipes then clear the windscreen. I think that's it. I don't think there's anything else I can show you, because that is every single thing in the dashboard. I'll tell you what, there is one thing. These seats, they all fold down like this, and I thought this is odd. It's got the original leather straps. Why would you want seats that fold down like that? Well, apparently, according to the handbook, it's for when it's raining and you've got the top off, and you can fold down the seats, and then it keeps the seats dry. Actually, there's one more thing. I might dare to show you something else on this. It has a starting handle, and if you're feeling brave, you don't start it on the starter button, you start it on the handle. I'll show you how that works now. What you do, you fit that through the bumper there, right down there, and I can just spy the engine. And you turn this handle, and it either breaks your arm off or it starts the engine. It's 50-50 generally. There you go. You still only use it in emergencies, really, but very useful to have when your battery's flat. Okay, well, here we go. Pre-flight checks on this one. Well, there aren't many. You just climb in and basically start it. There aren't even any safety belts in here because it's been 1954. Didn't have such things, such luxuries. There we go. Also, indicators. Well, they are optional extra. They weren't actually available when this was new. So I have a little switch here. So I have to keep an eye on that because obviously they're not self-canceling. That's about it. The other thing, just to test you, is you don't get synchromesh on first and second. So the gearbox makes a few clunks. In fact, there's so many noises going on from all the... Good idea to have a handbrake on. So many noises going on, I don't know how much you're going to hear of this.
it, any mechanical sympathy goes out the window if you try to go for top speed.
About the steepest bit of land I've got on the farm, this grass here. It's always impossible to show how steep it is on camera, but I promise you, you would not run up here. And we can't get a tractor up and down here for topping or anything like that. But it's also, obviously, a great place to try out your four-wheel drive and just see if you can get up the slope. So I'll take up the old Land Rover Series 1 and I'll show you what all those levers do and just see how good it is off-road. Seeing how an audience of cows now, I'm just going to show you this bit of off-roading and what all these levers do. Now, cows are very good at going up slopes, and this is a very steep slope. So they won't be that impressed, but I'm pretty impressed, right? You want to get out of the way, girls. They all think they're going to get fed, I reckon. Or they're just interested in Series 1s. Okay, so here's the slope. These properly steep. And if I just drive up here, just start it up, drive up here, guess what happens? We get stuck. And the reason for that is, what few people realise is these early Series 1s, well, the very early ones were permanent four-wheel drive, but this date, 1954 2-litre 86 being the wheelbase is how they're recognised, is actually always in two-wheel drive until you start moving these levers around. Now there's a yellow one. If I press the top of the yellow one, suddenly I'm now then in four-wheel drive, but I'm not going to get up here in high range, so I'm going to put it into low range, and that's this one. This is this red one here. I'd move it all the way back. Hey presto, I'm in four-wheel drive, and I'm really low here. You probably can't hear me anymore. Basically, in this gear, I can just go anywhere. Now, if I think if that fits wasn't there, I could go and climb a tree if I felt like it. And of course, you can go down. I'm the assistant cameraman today. I've got to run over. Morning. I quickly need to rescue the Range Rover. They've obviously decided that's where all the grub is. Oi, you lot! Get out of it! things I find amazing in this car is when you're in low range in the Series 1, it is properly low range. Keep an eye on the speedo at what speed I change gear. So we're going to first. Speedo doesn't even register. Second. Third. Oh, we're aiming for 10 miles an hour. And fourth. You're into fourth before 10 miles an hour. So I'm doing about 12 miles an hour. That is a seriously low range gearbox. There's another testing bit up here. Got an evil little jump in it. Again, we can't, all this is here, rough here, because we can't load it to the tractor. But this little thing just clambers up. This is a real car stopper. We've got a horrible little bang here. There we go. Oh, and off we go again. It's like it just gets over anything. There you go, that's a day in the life of a British icon, the Land Rover Series 1. This one example is 1954, so 60 years old this year. I'm amazed by it. I really enjoy owning this car. It's a different sort of car to the rest of the cars at the garage. But somehow you just know it's going to carry on working just like it has today for another 60 years. That's what I love about it. It's as tough as anything. Anyway, if you enjoyed the video, don't forget to subscribe to Harry's Garage. We'll be doing more videos like this, and they'll be coming along very soon. See you later. Okay, what I'll do, I'll bring the Range Rover up, and then when it stops, I reckon it won't get up here. If you just record it, and I'll sort of park it on the slope, and then I'll bring the old lady up, and that should go past it, okay?
That wasn't meant to happen. We'll have to have a plan B. Cow's coming to have a look.